On the screen. Yes, it started. Yes. Yeah, already there. Thank you, Prasad. Good morning, everybody. This is Lakshmi Narayan from UNOG. A warm welcome to all of you. Am I audible, team? Good morning, everybody on the call. This is Lakshmi Narayan from UNOGX. A warm welcome to all of you. Am I audible, team?
Hi, Lakshmi Narayan. Good morning. Yes, it is audible.
Yeah. If Manshu Dabra joined on two instances, yeah. Yes, now Venkat Reddy also joined. Shall we start the session? Am I good to start? I am Lakshmi Narayan, an experienced Oracle Financials consultant. I am carrying more than 18 years consulting experience with Oracle Financials. My experience spans into various activities with reference to the ERP consulting is concerned, right from the beginning of the as an end user, then as a consultant, as an architect, at various levels basically. Okay, and I am working with a product-based company, US product-based company. This is my brief background. I'm having a finance qualification as well. I request you, if you can introduce yourself, a few lines, it would be helpful for us to know each other. Can you please proceed? Any one of you can start, please. Maybe Syed.
Hi, good morning everyone. This is Sayed. So I'm an EBS, I'm working in EBS now, EBS techno functional areas. So I worked in supply chain modules, finance modules. So now going forward, I would like to work in Fusion. So that is why I have started learning Oracle Fusion Financials. So yeah, now I would like to work as a functional consultant going forward.
Syed, just request you, what is your expectation out of this training program? Can you briefly?
Expectation means now, since I have the background, so I need the details, like I would like to learn the functional, as a functional consultant, like what we need to know and what are the setups, how we implement the finance modules in at a customer side, all those things, I mean.
Oh, okay. Can anybody start again? maybe Vijay or Himanshu or Venkat Reddy. Hello. Hello. Am I audible, team? Hello. Okay, fine, no problem. Thank you. Thank you, Sayed, for a wonderful introduction for yourself. Definitely, this program has been designed in such a way which will enable the an individual to become a consultant and make them at least proficient, and they can carry on their work in any kind of in any kind of assignment, basically. Okay, we are going to have all the financial modules on the ERP. Let's have these classes maybe on a daily basis, and request your active participation as well, so that it will have the synergic effect and you will gain the most of the advantage out of this program. Team, anybody wants to introduce themselves? Please go ahead. Fine.
Yeah, hi, this is Sunil. I just joined, actually. I had some issues. So my name is Sunil Vij. So I'm working on Oracle Financials. So want to learn about the Financials Cloud.
Yeah, Sunil Vij. Thank you. Thanks for your warm introduction. Sunil, can you spell out what is your expectation out of this program?
My expectation is more like learning on the cloud financials. I've been doing financials for a long time. Mm-hmm. Like, I know very well the R12 modules, mm-hmm. financials. So want to learn the cloud functionality, because I'm not very well aware of the new terminology of the cloud and all. So want to understand that.
Oh, okay.
In hand, yes.
Yeah, so definitely let's help each other to understand and to gain more knowledge on the cloud financials and enable you to work towards that. Anybody else, team? My apologies, people are joining on the call, in fact. Yeah. Yeah, anybody else, they want to introduce themselves?
I'm sorry I joined late, but I didn't get your name.
Apologies, Sunil. My name is Lakshmi Narayan. Okay. You can call me as Lakshmi R. Narayan or Lakshmi Narayan. Okay. I'm an experienced Oracle Financials consultant. I'm carrying an experience around 18 years, and I'm a qualified financial professional. And I worked on various roles on the ERP implementation is concerned. And on cloud also, I have had an experience of on multiple implementations and various other kinds of projects like pre-sales, solution architect, and audits, and all those things.
So we'll learn a lot from you then. Thank you.
Yeah, definitely. Let's help each other. I'll try my level best to enable you people on the board.
Yeah.
My only request is just spend enough time after the class also, and going through the screens and going through the business processes, and try to make out most of this program basically.
Sure. Lakshmi, yeah. Upfront, I just want to ask, are you flexible on the time? Because, you know, like I'm in the US, so the time, the daylight saving just changed today.
Uh-huh.
So instead of my 6 o'clock in the Pacific time, it's 5 o'clock now, which is normally my working time. So are you flexible to like make it from either the 6:30 in the morning to like the 7 or 7:30 for you? You're fixed on the 6:30 time?
Let's work out with the management also. Let's update them. Why? Because other team members also there.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
It is workable to me, but it will be a little challenging to some. So, but a little bit more extra time will be helpful.
Let's check with the management.
Yeah? Sure. Thank you.
We will get back to you on that.
No problem. That's fine. Thank you.
Yeah. Anybody else to introduce themselves? Or otherwise, let's move into the presentation. We can start the discussion basically. One second, please allow me to talk. Venkat, you can speak. I think you are on mute basically. Can you unmute and speak yourself, Venkat? Hello, Venkat? Yeah, Vijay, please go ahead.
Yeah, I'm Vijay here. I have some experience with EBS cloud.
Uh-huh.
Interested in learning financial functional.
Mm-hmm.
And I missed the initial discussion. I'm sorry, if you can tell your name.
Yeah, Vijay, definitely. Sure.
And whatever initially discussed with Mr. Davra, if it is interested, if required for whole class to know.
Yes, Vijay. Definitely. My name is Lakshmi Narayan. I'm an experienced Oracle Financials consultant, and I'm carrying almost 18 years experience in the consulting. And I'm a qualified finance professional also. And I worked on various kinds of cloud implementations as well as EBS also. During the working on cloud applications, I worked on various roles like solution architect, then as a consultant, as an auditor. All these kinds of roles are there, and which provided me to a better understanding and insight into the application. Looking forward to work with each one of you to enable you on the financials applications so that we have a better understanding of each other. And finally, it will have an added advantage for you as well. My only request is request you to spend some time on the application so that to gain the most of the advantage out of this program. Is that fine, Vijay?
Very fine. Thanks a lot for all the information. And you go by Lakshmi Narayan or Lakshmi, or we can call you.
Yeah, you can call me as Lakshmi or Lakshmi Narayan. It's fine. No problem. Or Narayan also.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Anybody else wants to present themselves? Fine. No problem. At any given point of time, you can stop me, or you can ask me any questions or clarifications as well. I think most of the team is on the mute basically. Maybe they can unmute and they can present themselves. If nobody wants to present themselves, I will start the content basically. And this is the introductory class as of now. Today, what I will do is like I'll take you through what is the cloud applications and why it had become necessary for all of us to not do the on-premise thing basically. That is what the driving force. This cloud application technology has been started some 20 years back, if I remember properly. But to bring it on to the commercial uses and the people to depend on this technology, it took around, it started since last 10 years, if I remember, maybe 2011 kind of thing. But since then, the cloud applications development has started, and people are using artificial intelligence along with the cloud technology. Team, am I audible? Hello?
Yes.
Yes, this looks me.
Yeah, fine. So just before this pandemic, cloud applications were there and across the business, various organizations were using. But after the pandemic, it has changed the way we work and the dependencies on the on-premise applications, all these kind of things. But all said and done, most of these cloud applications facilitated to work remotely basically, and it reduced the dependency on the on-premise infrastructure basically. And Oracle applications being on the cloud took that advantage to provide more and more opportunities for the people who are working and who are intended to work as well. Now, what is this cloud application basically? And what are the various kinds of formats, or I would say like how it is being made as a technology basically. Okay, team, are you able to view my screen? I'm presenting one of the PPT which is showing as Oracle Fusion Financials. Please let me know. I cannot see your chat box basically. Somebody can spell it out, it would be good.
Yes, Lakshman.
Yeah. Okay. Now, let's see the agenda basically out of this thing. One is, let's see what is the cloud application, then what are the various product families out of the Oracle applications, then we will move further basically. Now, if we see the Oracle Fusion financial applications or Oracle Fusion applications as a product, it has its own advantages. Point number one is it's an built on the open standards basically, maybe Java kind of thing, and it's having the various technologies like Oracle Sova, WebLogic, JDeveloper, OBIEE, WebCenter Portal, WebCenter Content. These are the various technologies putting together that build these applications. Then built on the best business processes. Best business process, I mean, already there were ERP applications like Oracle ERP application, then PeopleSoft, JD Edwards, Siebel, okay, they put all the best processes on these applications and built these cloud applications. Then the third point, deployed through the selection of options. This is making us the more versatile as far as cloud applications are concerned. One is public cloud, the second one is private cloud, on-premise, and hybrid. Hybrid means where it's a public cloud as well as on-premise aspect. And on-premise, since right from the beginning, we were working on the on-premise kind of arrangement where all the infrastructure would be at the client space. The infrastructure, I mean, servers, all the users, everybody included at one place. Over a period of time, in the advancement of the technologies, they started using the VPN, that is virtual private networks, and then they started working on the internet. These are some of the developments due in the technology. Okay. Any questions, team? Okay. Then the advantages of the cloud is basically a customer or an organization need not spend any money on the infrastructure. They can simply start on with the URL. And especially with the Oracle application nowadays, they have started the data centers at various places. And due to the regulatory requirements at certain places like Saudi Arabia or in some countries in the Middle East where they want to have their customer data in the native country only. Okay, where Oracle, a corporation like Oracle, made all these things possible by having the presence of their data center in the respective places. Another major advantage of the Oracle applications is it is built on the best practices of the business. Best practices, I mean, these are complying to the various user requirements in order to provide the information which facilitates for the decision making, ease of use, accessibility, and flexibility as well. At the same time, it is providing the security also. On any cloud application or cloud way of working, the service provider takes the responsibility, has to take the responsibility of the security, which is true even in case of Oracle applications as well. Then it is the responsibility of the service provider to take the regular backups of the data. Why regular backups are required? In case of any eventuality, readily data is available and the application can be brought into the usage. Apart from that, a user can access the application from anywhere. He need not be present at his office or place of work. They can connect from their home or they can connect from any other place as well. Then one question will come up, is customizations are possible or not? Customization, I mean, tailoring an application or building a business process or a flow according to the unique requirements of an organization. These are some of the advantages. One second, yes. Yeah, somebody joined. Can you introduce yourself, please?
Yeah, Lakshmi, actually I joined earlier, but I lost my connection, so that's why I dropped.
Oh, okay.
This is Yash.
Yeah, Yash. Thank you. Now, if you see this slide, cloud deployment models, there are four rectangle boxes are there. The first one is on-premise. The second one is IaaS, that is infrastructure as a service. The third one is PaaS. PaaS means it's a platform as a service. The fourth one is software as a service. If you gradually moving from left side to right side of these rectangles or these boxes, from green to it is changing to color to the different orange color or peach color background basically. Okay. And on-premise, yes, we were working right from the beginning since long time. Then infrastructure as a service, what happens in this case is the service provider provides the infrastructure and the remaining maintenance and all those things would be coming up from the service provider. Then PaaS as a service, where the applications and data managed by the customer, but remaining all the running of the application and other infrastructure, whatever is required in terms of managing the applications like middleware, OS, and server, storage, networking, all those things would be taken care of by the service provider. SaaS as a service, that is software as a service. SaaS means here everything is being maintained by the service provider itself. Now, most of the customers across the globe are looking for this kind of arrangement. Why? Because it will be coming up with a plug and play option. The second one is no major dependency on the infrastructure. Somebody else will be taking care of that kind of the responsibility. The third point is accessibility and availability at any given point of time. Okay. So these are some of the arrangements, but depending on the requirements of the business and circumstances, they may be either going for the any one of these arrangements. Any questions, team? Okay, fine. Now let's come back to the Fusion product families. Oracle Fusion, they are providing, I would say, families means in terms of streams, basically, financials, human capital management, CRM. CRM stands for the customer relationship management, then project portfolio management, procurement, and supply chain management. Apart from these things, there is a risk management module is also available. Risk management, which previously it was known as GRC, which stands for governance, risk and compliance, which provides the various kinds of controls, basically. Controls, I mean to say, it will provide you if there is any circumvention of a control. Control means it's a system which prevents, detects, or corrects an unlawful event. Unlawful event, again, it's a definition by each of the organization, but most of the controls cannot be circumvented, or at least it will tell the a company like what is happening and what is the way forward. They have to take the corrective action in terms of certain cases. May not be all the cases, but definitely it provides a control mechanism. Team, any questions? Fine. The financial, yeah, go ahead.
Now, Lakshmi, what is project portfolio management? Is it printing?
Project portfolio management, let me give you a real life example. Say you are working on a software development. Maybe it's having multiple pieces of work and which consumes considerable time frame, and there are various milestones are there. Okay, it's an overall activity which is being carried out over a period of time, which will have various milestones. That is a software development. Let's take another example, like building a bridge or a flyover. It cannot be done in one night. It would be fragmented into various pieces of work. First, they will dig the foundation. Then they will build the foundation. On the foundation, they will put the pillars. On the pillars again, they will put the main way or the frame on which one can commute. So these things will take over a period of time, and it will be built over a period of time. Okay. Mm-hmm. And various kinds of stakeholders would also be involved. Once a project being start and put into use, lot of other activities will take place. One, when it is put into the use, then it would be either sold to a customer or it would be created as an asset for an organization. Here, there are, if you see project costing, which accumulates all the costs with reference to a project basically, and this PPM provides the infrastructure to define a project, to assign a project team, what are the various tasks are there, what are the various milestones are there, and accounting also, okay? And all these things would be taken care of by the project module. And project billing, if we see, it bills to the customer, then performance reporting, then how the various activities are controlled, then integration gateway, then project contacts also, okay? And this is one of the streams basically. And our, in our training program, we will be looking into the financials management, which is having the subject areas like general ledger, accounts payable, asset management, accounts receivables, and cash management, and expenses management. And underlying sub-ledger accounting method would be there wherever accounting is going to take place in these sub-ledgers. Then tax manager is also there. Most of the business events or transactions, taxation is also an underlying component. That also we will be taking care of in this
training. Sir, your voice is not clear, sir.
Is it okay now? Is it audible now?
No, sir. Audible, but some disturbance is going.
Oh. One second.
Completely disturbance, sir.
Is it audible now? Is it clear?
Hello? Yes.
Yeah, it is clear to us.
Yeah, it is clear for me as well.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Yes. Thanks, Lakshmi. Thanks for the details.
Thank you. Now, another advantage of the Oracle applications is they release multiple versions, that is at least 4 versions in a calendar year, which will be including the additional or new features or enhancements. And based on the various problems, they keep on providing the patches for the any new features or any bugs or any other limitation basically. Okay. And this is being taken care by the Oracle itself. And whenever there is a new version is available, there is a clear-cut information is available for all the user community. Then as we discussed previously, as a part of the financials, we will be having the general ledger, intercompany accounting, payables, receivables, payments, cash management, taxation, expenses, and assets. Okay. Each of these areas would be having a unique objective and purpose. Now, general ledger is the core for all the accounting, and subledgers like payables, receivables, fixed assets, these are the work areas, or you can call a module or part of the financials, which are being used for the various other unique purposes. Let me, I'll take you into the application, then we will see each of these areas also. Then what is the reporting capability of the cloud application? It's one of the, compared to the previous EBS offerings and now on the cloud applications, The major advantage is integration with the business intelligence and various capabilities of the reporting in terms of the financial reporting center than BI reporting, that is business intelligence reporting, and users can build an analysis with the usage of the various available subject areas from each of the streams. Then we have smart view reporting. All these things are possible with the advantage of having the cubes, basically. Okay, I'll take you through these cubes. If any of you having the technical background or having array knowledge on the arrays, it's a kind of arrangement of the data in terms of arrays, which provides the flexibility to take the reporting in multiple dimensions. That is the advantage of these cubes, basically. Any questions, team? Fine. Now I'm sharing, taking you to the application. Team, are you able to view my screen?
Yes.
Yeah.
This is the home screen. Let me come back and let me sign out. Basically, I signed in as one of the users. Okay. See, in order to start any session on this cloud applications, we need to have a URL, basically. Okay. This URL would be like this. ESET-SAAS-FADEMO1.DS. They give that oracledemos.com. This is the URL. Based on that, once we type it, it will provide us the hot to log into the application. Now my user is fin_impl, and I'm having a, I need to provide the credentials in terms of user ID and password. This is my home screen. Okay. And this is the launch pad, and this, the, through this home screen only, we will be accessing the application. Okay. Now, if you observe here on the top, there is a logo is there. Since this is a demo instance, Oracle logo is there. Otherwise, generally the customer's logo would be there. And if you see the below the good morning FinIMPL, there are various tabs are there. Sales, service, me, procurement, my client groups, help desk, product management, like this, all the offerings are provided here. Since for me, the access is available for all these areas, but it may not be required for a particular user. Say, for example, who is working in the payables department of a finance section. For them, general ledger may not be required. Okay. So these applications provide the access based on the role, which is called role-based access control. Okay. And the second level of security is, even it will restrict the access based on the specific business organization or specific business division, basically. Say, a particular company is operating in motor vehicles as well as insurance. As an organization, we want to have a clear-cut demarcation of the employees between the motor vehicles division and insurance division. We can define two different organizations, and we can provide the access only to the motor vehicles organization for an accounts payables clerk. It is a role-based access discipline. So all these kind of access controls are available, and data security is also available. Data partition is also available. Here, for all the practical purposes, we are seeing this, all the applications available under all the work areas, I would say, on the application. Okay. And this is the home screen. And these are the favorites. One can place the favorites. And if you see this bell icon, the notifications, whatever each of the job or any changes we are doing or any approvals are required or any kind of activity is being taken place on the application, a notification gets generated. And if you see this FinIMPN, this is my user. And if I click on this, it will show me the other functionality basically, okay? And whenever a user wants to log out, they can click on the sign out and log out. And on the top left side, there is, if you see three horizontal lines are there, it is again a navigator. If I click on that, it will show me the various offerings here, okay? And if I say, for example, if I click on payables, there are again three work areas are there. One is payables dashboard, invoices, and payments. Okay. Let me click on the come out of it. Right from the beginning, we were discussing on the security and controls basically. Why a control is required or necessary means, in order to have the proper data on the applications at any given point of time, a control is mandatory. Maybe we may be knowing or we may not be knowing, but we do design and solution a business requirement in the purview of the controls required by the an organization. What I mean to say control is, say for example, if somebody wants to enter a transaction with a future date, which should not be the case. If a future expense cannot be recorded or a future expense cannot be paid, maybe it may be an advance kind of thing, but generally it should not be done. And at the same time, I'll give you one more example, a date of birth. It cannot be in a future date. A date of birth always can be a past date, okay? So the application should be in a position to stop us if somebody is entering this kind of data which is not real or which is not relevant, okay? So what, as an architect or as a consultant, we need to consider all these kind of controls basically, and we need to understand, and these kind of controls are built in the form of configurations. And these configurations also provided based on the various offerings. Let me go to the home screen. Yeah, I'm there. Now let's go into the setup and maintenance. Let me show you. This is setup and maintenance is the place where we do the configuration. And how we are controlling, I'll show you that also. Say, if I click on this actions here, there are various offerings are there. Now, what I mean to say offering, say a particular user X is there or a particular consultant X is there. We want to provide the access to the financials only. So it has to be enabled. It has to be bought in by a specific organization. And if something is not required, we will not enable that offering at all. Say here, there are various offerings, compensation management, customer data management, financials, accounting app, grants management. All these are offerings. And for each of the offering, there would be features also available. Say we need to opt in those features. Let me go into the features as well. It's taking little time. let it open. And whenever there is a new release is also there, we can go and enable those new features as well. If you see here, general ledger, for example, the general ledger, it's been enabled here. And if I click on the features, okay, these are the some of the features available, and we can go and enable here. Say, for example, allocation rule name as a reconciliation reference. Okay, we need to enable it. This by default, this is not enabled. By having this enable or not enable kind of option, we are controlling the access basically, and we are controlling the not to commit any kind of mistake in the system. Okay, from this offering itself, we can have these kind of controls in the system. Now let me click on done. Done means I'm coming out of this particular features option. Team, any questions? Am I going fast? Am I audible? Are you able to understand my lecture?
Yes, Lakshmi, I'm fine.
Yeah, thank you. Likewise, these are the various features. Maybe suppliers is there, payables is there, payments is there. Each one of the respective areas we can go and we can enable the features. Now click on done. In the financials, if there are some new features are there. Here, we can go inside and we can opt in, okay? You see here, these are the, some of these things are enabled and it gives the, in which feature also it is available. What is this 21C? Previously, as we discussed, Oracle releases versions, maybe at least 4 versions in a year. Okay, 21 indicates the year. This is 2021. And C is the third release in 21 year, 2021. Generally, it would be A, B, C, and D. Okay, D also already there in the pipeline already, it's been released basically. And whenever there is a new release is there, clients or an organization will have an option to upgrade into the new one and opt in for the new features. In some cases, these features would be coming automatically. In some cases, they need to enable it. Say, for example, there is a functionality called joint venture accounting. For all the organizations, joint venture accounting may not be required. Just I'm giving an example. If one has to use the joint venture accounting, whatever the new offering had come up, they have to go and enable. Okay. Now, like this, whenever there is a new feature is there, the users or the an organization will have that option to enable it. Let me come out of this. Okay. And as a part of the financials, we need to understand that one is financials offering is there. The second one is Fusion Accounting Hub is there. By default, out of the financials and Fusion Accounting Hub, general ledger and subledger accounting would be enabled by default. Remaining subledgers, you may enable or may not enable. What are the subledgers like receivables, payables, fixed assets? Okay. Say, where these things become relevant also, I'll explain you. If we take a case of banks, a specific bank like a Standard Chartered Bank or Bank of America, there, for them, receivables may not be relevant on the Oracle application. They may be using a different application to record the business related operations, maybe FlexCube. It's a It's an application which provides for the banking industry. Okay. So now how these two things would be integrated from the FlexCube, information would be interfaced to the Oracle General Ledger, or maybe from the Oracle General Ledger to FlexCube GL, the information passage would be there. It's an implementation decision. Okay. So it provides the flexibility to transfer the data into another system or a third party system, and from a third party system to the Oracle application as well. Okay. And what is the major advantage of having any kind of ERP is it has to be integrated. Integrated, I mean to say, there should be a single source of truth which facilitates the sharing of the information across the streams, across the stream. And I'll give you an example. If there is a record or there is an entity called supplier, the supplier is an entity with whom an organization does the business by way of procuring the goods or services. In order to procure these goods or services, there would be a predefined contract would be there. That contract is called as a purchase order. So now here what happens when we are creating a purchase order, a supplier reference is required. When we are creating an invoice in order to make the payment towards the goods or services supplied by a supplier, again, we need to have a supplier record. In both these cases, we are accessing or assigning towards the same entity. It is called supplier. So if you create one supplier, say for example, ABC Limited, it would be available for both procurement as well as financials. Likewise, there is an employee defined on the application. This employee would need to be available or need to perform various activities across the application, say for example. In that case, the single source of truth is this employee record. Whatever the access and business areas they want to operate, it would be controlled and it would be provided through the access basically. Okay. So this is an integrated application with having a single source of truth. We can record our business transactions and we can report it to the respective stakeholders. Any questions, team? Let me come out of this offerings. Okay. Now, if you see, we have the configurations based on the respective subjective area. If you see here, this is setup financials. If I open this dropdown, I am having various other offerings like compensation management, data management, then enterprise contract, financials, financial accounting hub, Fusion Accounting Hub, grants management, okay. Based on our requirement, we can go into the respective offerings and we can access the each respective area. The other advantage is whenever we are configuring an application, all the related and mandatory configuration steps are listed sequentially. And a user can go and check what is the required, or they want to see the all the configuration steps available on the application. Now, say for example, if I'm on the general ledger offering up as a part of the financials. If you see here, the show required tasks are there and all tasks are there. Now, what is a task? Task is a job or some configuration step which we have to perform in order to gain a specific functionality. By default, application opens as a configuration aspect with the related tasks. But if somebody wants to view all the tasks, they can click on by choosing the all tasks, and system will show us all the tasks available for this particular functional area called general ledger. Say, here if you see here, this is a shared module. If I click on this shared, it will show us like it is shared with the Financial Fusion Accounting Hub. Okay, that means a general ledger, when we are defining, that general ledger is being shared with Fusion Accounting Hub also. Okay, it will tell us like how this information is shared with, or what are the other business models or modules with which this particular configuration is being shared. At the same time, if you see another drop down is there, if I click on that, it will tell us like we can see what is the what are the various documents and implement, what is the implementation status, feature selection you can set, you can change the feature selection, then you can have a setup data report, we can export these configurations, we can import. Okay, there are various functionalities available. Now let me go into the ledger definition. Ledger definition, always it is with reference to the scope only. What do you mean by scope? Scope is a work area where we are intended to work basically. I say, for example, my organization is based out of Dubai. And I am working, or I need to do some kind of changes in the ledger of a Dubai-based ledger, or say a ledger which is recording the transactions of US, whatever it is. So particular entity I need to access, so I can control my scope basically. Say, let me click on this task called specify ledger options. Okay, so I can go here directly. When I give the scope of that particular ledger, that ledger only gets opened. These are the various configuration related information, like what is the accounting calendar, what is the subledger accounting method we are going to use, and during the period close process, what should be the my retained earnings account, if there are translations are there, what should be the cumulative translation adjustment account, and what are the kinds of rates we are going to take, foreign currency exchange rates, then document sequencing, as well as whether we want to enable the approvals or not. Okay, these are the various configuration related aspects with reference to the ledger is concerned. Okay, with these all functionality we can enable by going into this task called specify ledger option. Okay, and we can say we can save, and you can do that, or we can save and close completely, or we can click on the cancel to come out of the screen. Team, any questions, team? Am I going fast or slow? You can tell, please let me know. Your feedback is very important.
You're good.
Thank you. So this is the configuration related area. Now let me take you to the one of the entries or transactions where we enter. Let me click on the home screen and let's go to the general ledger. It is called general accounting. Okay, if you see here, there are three work areas are there. One is general accounting dashboard, the second one is journals, the third one is period close. Just let me open the, click on the journal. A journal is a an accounting entry, or you can say a transaction recording in the system by providing both the aspects of accounting, that is debit and credit. Okay, let me click, go to a journal entry. In detail, I'll explain you each of the screens also. But at this point of time, just would like to show how JV looks on the system basically. Okay. Here, this is my create journal page, and always it is with reference to a data access set. What is data access set? Is my allowed or where I am allowed to work. I am allowed to work with US primary ledger. So that is forming part of my data access set. In order to provide an access or without a data access, a user will not be able to work in their specific area. Say, for example, here I need to work on the ledger called US primary ledger. Prior coming to here, somebody has to provide me the access to work in this particular ledger or entity. It is called data access set. So this is my primary starting point. One need to know basically where we have to work or where we are authorized to work. Okay. So this is a journal batch description. All the fields, relevant fields are there. If you see, there is an asterisk mark is there, which is a mandatory field. What does it mean? This, in this case, without accounting period, you cannot record a journal entry. Okay. And this is a journal batch and this is a journal period. And these are the journal lines. If you see here, this is one debit and one credit. Okay. And if I click on this particular magnifying glass with the deck, it is providing my account representation. We need to provide a representation or we need to provide an account in order to record a transaction. Okay. By having these things, we will restrict the user committing the mistake. They may be doing a wrong thing, but we can restrict the user not to commit a mistake, basically. Not to commit a mistake in the sense, they need to provide this full code combination. Then only that account is being represented in the system. Now, doing the wrong thing means, say, for example, in place of an account code or natural account value 1001, if somebody is choosing 1007, it's the wrong thing, basically. Okay. But if somebody is not providing the account, system will not allow them to complete the accounting entry. It will tell the users, boss, you need to provide this complete code combination. These are the kinds of controls are enabled and inbuilt in the system. Okay, this is one journal entry screen. Let's see the journal entry also. Say, for example, here, this is one journal batch. Let me open this thing. And one more point is, this is called a dashboard also. If you see here, in the journal screen, in the journals, it is showing there are three tabs are there in this dashboard. One is requiring attention, means some problem is there on this particular JV. If you see here, what it is saying, there is an issue and it's an error, unapproved journal batch. And one more is the during the approval process, this JV has been rejected. Okay. Like this, then if you click on incomplete or if you go to the incomplete, it is not completed. Then you can import the errors also. Now let me go to a specific JV. You see here, they have entered this JV. Okay. But they have not completed it. Not completed in the mean. I mean, they need to save it, complete it, and then they need to post it. If you see here, as of now, approval is the status is required. And funds status means budgetary control, funds is not been attended, and batch status is unposted. Unless if it is not posted, it will not give any kind of impact in the system. And completion status also incomplete. It provides us the complete status where we stand. And it is also integrated with the social network within the organization. say a manager and subordinate are there, and if they want to communicate with each other, social messaging like your Slack or maybe what do you call Facebook kind of thing. It may not be external, it may be internal within the organization. Okay, what it is saying, you are not a member of general batch of on the Oracle network. Let me click on join. Let's see, it will provide us the access or not. It's taking a little time. Any questions, team? Fine, it's still opening. Yeah, if you see here, this is a general batch, and there is a gentleman called Brody Smith. We can chat with them, okay? We can see what is the status and if there are any adjustments has to be there, or any kind of messaging is enabled actually. And they can upload the documents, all the whatever we do on the our normal day-to-day business activity, means your communication is intact and continuous. Okay. Now let me come out of this screen. Let me show you one of the subledger related activities also. Okay, let's go to the payables as well. Now, if we see in the payables, we have three work areas. One is payables dashboard and invoices and payments. Okay, now let me click on the invoices. Invoice means it's a liability basically. Here, if you see these rectangles, these are infolets basically, which will provide us the status. Now, say if I click on the this recent tab, it will show me in the last 24 hours one new invoice is being created. Okay, now from at the single glance itself, I can know what is the status of this particular invoice, whether it's validated or not, whether it's an accounted or not, whether it's paid or not, when it was created, and what was the last updated date, and what is the business unit. Okay, all these various information is available. Even I can include some of the other columns. Say you can hide certain columns. Say for example, I do not want to see the paid status. Okay, it's gone, it's not. So a user can can choose whatever they want to see and how they want to work basically. Okay, you see here they can do the activities from here itself. They want, if somebody wants to create a new transaction, they can create it from here, validate it, cancel it, or posting it to a ledger is accounting basically. Okay, let me click on to this particular transaction, payables invoice. Team, any questions, team?
I'm good.
Thank you, Sunil. Okay. If you see here, this is one of the invoices which consists of the invoice header, where we have the supplier and other related information like invoice number, what is the supplier site for, what is the legal entity name, okay, what are the payment terms. And if I click on lines, it will show me what is the expense item basically, okay, on this particular invoice, and what are the related taxes. Now, one doubt must have come. A user, is it necessary to enter all the information on this particular screen? No, it may not be the case. Say, for example, if we choose a particular supplier called ABC Consulting, automatically the system will give you the supplier site and other related information which can be defaulted from the supplier site or supplier definition. Okay. So this defaulting and single source of truth, and which will make the life of the a user are very easy and comfortable, and it will reduce the chance of committing a mistake, basically. Okay. Here, if you see here, this is the total tax amount and what is the due amount. Okay. And in this case, there is some withholding tax is also applicable. And by clicking on this particular hyperlink, it will show us what is the status also. It is validated, it's not accounted at, it's not paid at. The payment status is showing as not paid. What is the due date of this particular invoice and other related holds, if there are any. In this case, there are no holds placed. Hold means an error committed by a user, which is obstructed by the system, basically. Okay, it will stop us. It will not allow us to move forward. And one more thing also, just would like to show you. This is an indicator. If you see here, there is one available prepayment, 6,700 USD. That means a particular supplier is having an advance on him or that particular organization which need to be applied or which can be used against a specific invoice. Just I'm giving you an example of how this application looks and what are the various controls are available. And as an example, we have seen a few configuration related aspects and a journal screen and a payables invoice screen. But this is not limited. Each of these areas we would be working in more detail, in fact. As an introduction, just to provide you the orientation towards the application, just I have taken you through these screens. I encourage each one of you to have any kind of questions or clarification, please feel free to discuss. If you are not able to get it on the class, you can send the questions to this specific mail ID, this info@unogix.com. Okay. So somebody will assign it or inform us so that in the next day class, we can discuss it or we can get it clarified. I hope you understood and you could able to reciprocate whatever I'm explaining. Please provide me the feedback as well. It would be useful for the benefit of both of us. For the next process, you can get in touch with one of the management team, maybe Prasad, or you can touch base with the management team using this contact number, basically. Okay. Any questions, team? Any clarifications? Please go ahead.
Is it Monday to Friday, or what are you planning to schedule this?
As of now, I got the mandate to conduct the classes from Monday to Saturday.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm stopping the sharing. Okay. Yeah. Any other questions, team? Please go ahead.
Hi, Lakshmi. What kind of server access do we get? Do we get public domain access, or do we get any private server access? I had experience.
Yeah, go ahead, Sayed.
Because I noticed, like, whenever we access public server domain access, it used to be very slow. So
Sayed, it's a very good question. Actually, it's a completely a private server. Okay. There are there might be multiple instances might be available. Okay. at any given point of time, without any hassle, you can have the access to the application. Once all the formalities are completed, the management team might be providing you the list of the instances and what are the user credentials also. And as you mentioned, it cannot be a public server, Sayed.
Okay. Because now in the initial classes today, we logged in a public.
It's server. Not a public server, Sayed.
Okay.
It's not a public server. See, basically our group only might be using these instances. I'll explain you how it works basically. Today, in order to access the application, first point is we need to have the URL, that is access URL. Then having URL itself is not sufficient. One needs to have the credentials also, credentials in the form of user ID and password. Okay. So in that way, they are controlling the access basically. And it would be provided to the dedicated users only.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. And then how do we start? Like what is the course content? Like do we start from creating the organization, business unit, legal entities, all those, or how? Because I would like to, I'm interested in that area. How do we start? What is the plan going forward?
Very good question, Sayed. In fact, I do not want to confuse you by stating it in the beginning itself, but yes, in the course content, we will start from the organization structure in terms of what is a ledger and what is a business unit and what's an enterprise. I will be taking you through each of these areas and how these things are interrelated, how a specific organization called, say, for example, business unit is linked with a legal entity, and what are the various functions of a business unit, how in turn it is related to a ledger, and how a specific transaction is being created as an asset, all these integration aspects and business flow from one module to another module, say, for example, payables to general ledger, payables to fixed assets, how all these flows are going to take place, all those things will be taken care of. If we take the case of financials are having the modules like general ledger, which is the central repository for all the accounting information. Payables is a sub ledger which captures all the transactions related to the payables and employees or suppliers. Okay. These things would be captured with the multiple kinds of information. I mean to say a particular transaction, who is the supplier and what are the various payment terms, what are the items brought in and what are the taxes applicable, what is the payment made, what kind of payment or what is the mode of the payment. All this information would be captured at the subledger level, and accounting information is being transferred to the general ledger so that financials can be prepared. And using these two work areas, maybe reporting might be taken care of depending on the reporting requirement. At the same time, there are multiple standard reports are available on the application. Okay, BI publisher reports are available in the format of PDF, in the format of Excel, in the format of Word, PPT, or somebody can take it in the form of CSV or XML kind of thing. Okay, these are the various formats. All this information is available, and we will be covering and we will be taking you through and we will be discussing all those aspects as well. Whatever the various rapid implementation sheets are available and what are the ADFDI tools or FBDI upload, all these things we will be discussing.
Okay, okay, yes. And one more last question.
Yes, please.
This how long the course duration is, like how many days to be completed, what is the plan?
We as per our curriculum and the plan, okay, this will take us around 4 to 5 weeks, Sayed.
4 to 5 weeks, okay.
Yeah, 4 to 5 weeks, or we can speed up also. At max, that is a estimation I can give you.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Thanks, Lakshmi. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Sayed. I'll tell you like how we will go is I'll be explaining you the business concept and I'll be presenting it through the application itself. Okay. It's not only the discussion part, it's through the application also. Yes, Himanshu.
Please provide the recording audio of this session.
It would be available, Himanshu.
Please share it.
Yeah. Lakshmi, I feel that the more we handle through the application, so that throughout in the next like 4 to 5 weeks, we get completely hands-on into the application.
Yes,
that would be great for us.
That is the only way through which we will be able to gain more advantage, basically.
Yes. I mean, I'd rather more go on to the practical than the theory.
Like
reading a book. I get into the application.
Yes, this discussion is warranted and your presence on the application is more beneficial, in fact.
Mm-hmm. I agree. Yes. Okay, so we'll do it tomorrow, same time?
Yes, Sunil. Tomorrow at the same time. Any other questions, Tim? I hope you have the numbers also, right?
Yes, I have.
Yeah. Let me share if you need one more time. Yeah, this is a 9+91 7396033555 and the mail ID also info@unogeeks.com. Do you want me to paste it?
I got it. Lakshmi, no need for that. Thank you.
Yeah. If there are no questions or any further clarifications, I request you to please get in touch with the management for the further process so that we can continue further.
Thank you very much, Lakshmi.
Yeah.
So we'll continue tomorrow.
Yes. Good day, team.
You too.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you, everyone. Bye.
Bye.